Ladies and gentlemen, very welcome to this special event of the EUI, the annual degree awarding ceremony. Before starting the procedure, I would kindly ask you to control whether your cell phones are switched off or put to silent mode. You will have found on your chairs headsets. These are not providing translations, but it's just to make sure that everything is heard well in different parts of the church. Thank you. I will ask the president of the EUI, Professor Weiler, to open this ceremony.
Professor Perron, Professor Zeleny, my distinguished colleagues, our wonderful doctoral and master graduates, but last and not least, fathers, mothers, grandparents, husbands, wives, partners, children, brothers and sisters, the families. It's a precious moment for you, and it's a precious moment for us. You have every reason to be proud of the people that are sitting here, and that in a few minutes will officially receive the doctorate degree. Make no mistake, writing a doctorate is not an easy process. It involves hard work, suffering, but above all, a lot of self-doubt. And that self-doubt is not because we select people who are insecure, because self-doubt is essential to the keen academic and intellectual mind. We have to be self-critical at any moment. So it's a truly wonderful, remarkable, and exceptional moment when these young people finish, complete their dissertation, defend it before an international jury, and now come before us to be awarded with their degree. I want to say something about the EUI. It's a very special place. There are lots of universities around the world which have students from around the world. Paris, in London, in Boston, in Berlin, in any of these famous places and famous universities, there will be students from many, many countries. Where we are different, where we are different and where we are special, that when I think of those universities, even if they're students from all over the world, if you're at Sciences Po in Paris, it's a very, very French institution. If you're at Cambridge in the United Kingdom, it's a very, very English institution. If you're at the EUI, it's hard even to tell you what it is, but it is none of the above. And I think now that you are graduating, you realize that apart from the courses and the research and the methodologies that you learned, the very existence in this place had not a negligible added value to the experience of doing the master's and the doctorate. The value of a conversation with other people, with other countries, in an environment that does not privilege any particular national orientation, and a certain humility that is bred by meeting different points of view, and a realization that sometimes there's more one way to look for the truth. Finally, a word about Europe. Europe is not in good shape. And part of this not being in good shape that in many of our societies, it brings out the worst of us. So to you who are graduating and moving on to the next stage in your lives, I hope you will take with us not only the skills, the knowledge that you acquired here in doing your research, but also a sense that you are custodian of our civilization and our civility. I wish you all good luck, and once again to the families, there's every reason to be very, very proud today. Thank you.
We will start the ceremony today with the awards of the honoris causa degrees. I would like to invite honorary promoter Laura Downs to address Michel Perrault.
L'histoire s'adosse à l'oubli. History rests on those who have been forgotten, wrote Michel Perrault in 2001. Indeed, social history is traditionally focused on the fundamental structures that lie at the heart of societies, leaving society's margins unexplored. But Madame Perrault has always been interested in history's silences, in that which has been forgotten and those who have been pushed to the margins. Peasant workers in the early years of France's industrialization. Prison as a technology of power that is both hidden and visible. The history of women, whose oppression built on their exclusion from education, civic and political rights, and decently paid labor, has also entailed their erasure from history. Michel Perrault's first book, La Jeunesse de la Grève, focused on worker protest in late 19th century France, when the working class was still in formation, moving gradually from the peasant world of charivari to the factories and mines of the industrializing nation. They carried with them the rites of charivari, singing and dancing la farandole, and exchanging Lily of the Valley on the 1st of May. All of these entered into the repertoire of worker protest. And so the strike was not only a moment of violent confrontation, it was also one of celebration, as women and men escaped the relentless, dreary regime of factory labor and poured onto the streets in a flood of expression, singing, dancing, chanting, waving flags and banners. I remember the strikes of 1936, recalled Madame Perrault, when the Popular Front had just come to power. In my neighborhood, the textile factories fell silent as the women workers streamed out onto the streets and filled them with the sound of their young, sometimes very young, voices. There are clear existential and political reasons that explain my desire to escape institutional history in favor of those shadowy zones that lie far from the state and from the history of politics. But surely there are also moral ones having to do with my Catholic education. For although I am an atheist, the idea of the other, l'autrui, that I acquired in the course of that Catholic education remains with me to this day. Given her own personal story, a child at the time of the Popular Front, a young girl sent to Catholic schools several years later, during the dark years of France's occupation, it is perhaps not surprising that Michel Perrault decided to study history, a field that corresponded well to her serious nature and desire to understand the searing conflicts. That in 1947, Madame Perrault enrolled at the Sorbonne. Here she worked with renowned quantitative historian Ernst Labrousse, who drew in the crowds with his eloquent speech, his commitment to working class history, and his rigorous approach to the history of economic structures and conditions. It was during these years that Madame Perrault's life of political militancy also began, as she got involved in circles of students and young teachers, working in tandem with the worker priest movement of the 1940s and 50s, early 50s. As a young school teacher in Caen, Michel Perrault accompanied future colleagues and her future husband, Jean-Claude Perrault, into the working class districts around the Société Métallurgique de Normandie, where they conducted socio-anthropological studies of local religious, family, and cultural practices. But in 1955, the Vatican brought the worker priest experiment to an abrupt halt, excommunicating any and all priests who stubbornly pursued this path. At that point, Madame Pirot broke with the church that had shaped her youth and joined the Communist Party. It was 1955. France's dirty war in Algeria was heating up fast, and the communists were the principal force of opposition to this cruel and unjust war. Yet the communists were not without their own difficulties, what with Khrushchev's 1956 denunciation of Stalin's crimes at the 20th Party Congress, followed some 8 months later by the Soviets' violent suppression of the Hungarian Revolution. So in 1958, when Madame Pirot left Conf for Paris, she quietly let her membership drop. She nonetheless continued to feel a fellow traveler for many years thereafter, and rejected not only Cold War anti-communism, but any and all criticism of the party. In this way, she says, I participated in the great illusion of my generation. Scholarship and political militancy would continue to feed each other in a remarkably productive dynamic over the next 58 of her years of her career. As she put it, I lived May 68 and its aftermath with great intensity as a maître assistante at the Sorbonne. Women were very present, but as second-class citizens only. When in 1971, I took up an assistant professorship as one of the founding members of the newly established Université de Paris 7, we were able to put a new seminar on the program devoted to the marginal and the excluded, an interdisciplinary exploration that was animated by the conviction that history is moved as much by the margins as it is by the center. These were the years of important prison riots in France, 1970 to 74, and Paris 7 was deeply implicated, teaching classes inside the prisons, while Madame Perrault's friend and colleague Michel Foucault organized, in conjunction with other colleagues, the information group on prisons. Madame Perrault's second book, major book, L'impossible prison, on the 19th century carceral system, drew inspiration from these experiences as well as from Foucault's thinking on the subject. The prison is a technique of governmentality that is central to social order, yet also hidden in its daily operations. At the same time, and one really wonders where and how she found the time, Michel Perrault was deeply implicated in the women's movement, organizing with sociologist André Michel France's first course on the history of women, which, as she recalls, opened in a stormy atmosphere as the boys, especially the leftists, loudly hissed and heckled us all. She also met regularly with the Groupe d'études féministes, a consciousness-raising group that she'd set up with Françoise Bache in 1974. The group opened up broad avenues to the Anglophone world of women's studies. As Françoise Bache was employed in the university's Anglophone studies program, through which important and enduring contacts were made with British and American feminists. Michel Perrault would soon find herself paying dearly for this contact, as from the late 1970s onward, she became the feminist historian of reference, looking after us all as we washed up, one after another, eager but ignorant, on the banks of the Seine. It was in the sparsely documented history of women that Michel, by now a confirmed specialist of the margins, faced the most stubborn challenges yet in her determination to illuminate the shape of experience in history's most obscure nether regions. In order to do this, she practiced with great intelligence and sensitivity the interdisciplinarity that was constitutive of women's and gender history as a subdiscipline, drawing in particular on the tools and approaches of contemporary ethnography. She also sought to overcome the terrible paucity of sources on the hidden history of women through the creative use of non-traditional sources, developing techniques that were hardly familiar to historians in the 1970s and 80s, but which have since entered the mainstream. Oral history, the history of memory, the study of material objects and material culture. By rehabilitating all kinds of written sources that have been seen as too minor, too personal, too idiosyncratic to serve as historical sources, I strove to recover the words of those who lived in history's shadows, recalled Michel Perrault, and so bring these evanescent subjects back into the historical record. For to make them objects of history is to give them an existence. After all, things do not exist except through the narratives that we write. If you have no properly historical approach to these shadowy zones on the margins, then the darkness sets in forever and oblivion submerges everything. For forgetting creates an unfathomable sea.
Ultimately, her meditations on historical epistemology led Michel Perrault to write her remarkable Histoire des Chambres, which offers a magnificent illustration of that which many of us have long known to be true, that the tools developed to recover the history of women can be fruitfully applied to other topics in such a way as to open out dimensions of human experience that are difficult to grasp and yet lie close to the heart of what it means to be human, the modes of subjectivity and sociability that are shaped by the slum housing of industrial workers, the prison cell, or the closed rooms of bourgeois femininity, the sense of creative space and of individual being that thrives in the room of one's own, famously celebrated by Virginia Woolf and Anatole France. Over the course of her long and variegated career, Michel Perrault has played a central role in reinvigorating France's very rich tradition of social and cultural history, precisely through her decision to remain on the margins and invent techniques and sources for shedding light on subjects that most of her colleagues had deemed impossible, incapable of study. A pioneer on every level, Michel Perrault breathed new life into the fields of social and cultural history, making a vital contribution to the renewal of a field that scholars and pundits have for the past 25 years been only too happy to declare dead. The history of the generally unheard from, on whose oppression and exploitation rest the more familiar stories of states, economies, and elites. I invite Michel Perrault to the platform to speak. Thank you.
Monsieur le Président, Monsieur le Secrétaire Général, Madame, chers collègues, chers étudiants, chers amis, c'est un grand honneur pour moi que de recevoir aujourd'hui cette distinction que je ne mérite pas du tout. Dans ce lieu magnifique, impressionnant, et dans une institution d'une telle qualité, qui recrute des enseignants remarquables venus de toute l'Europe, du monde entier. Et c'est un honneur particulier de le recevoir en compagnie du professeur Zeleny. C'est vraiment un grand honneur dont je vous remercie infiniment. Et je voudrais aussi remercier les organisateurs de cette réunion qui savent faire d'une cérémonie avec son rituel, en même temps une rencontre festive et joyeuse. Merci en particulier à l'infatigable Beate Hinson, à laquelle toutes les personnes qui viennent ici savent ce qu'elles doivent. Ce doctorat resserre mes liens avec l'Institut où je suis venue à plusieurs reprises dans le passé, pour des thèses, pour des colloques, pour des rencontres diverses. Et je lui fais des vœux pour que cette institution continue dans le sillage glorieux qu'elle a tracé depuis 1976. Et je pense que les étudiants qui sont ici ne connaissent peut-être pas totalement le bonheur qui est le leur d'être ici dans la beauté et dans la rencontre. Ce doctorat resserre également mes liens avec l'Italie. L'Italie qui a tant compté pour tant de gens et pour moi en particulier, à la fois par sa beauté, par sa pensée, par son expérience dans tant de dimensions. Et en particulier en histoire, pour moi, ça a été très important. D'abord dans le domaine de l'histoire sociale, il y a bien longtemps, et je sais que ça existe toujours, une fondation, Basso, qui développait beaucoup l'histoire sociale. Et puis, l'histoire des femmes en Occident, que j'ai co-dirigée avec Georges Duby, qui lui aussi a été un professeur heureux en Italie ô combien, eh bien cette histoire est venue de l'initiative d'un éditeur italien, La Terza. C'est lui qui avait proposé d'écrire une storia della donna que nous avions rapidement, mes amis et moi, transformé en storia delle donne, au pluriel. Et il y a un mois, j'étais à Rome pour le 25e anniversaire de cette déjà très vieille histoire des femmes en Occident. Et cette réunion était organisée par l'Association des historiennes italiennes sous la présidence de Isabelle Chabot. Ce fut une rencontre magnifique. C'est dire les liens historiques que j'ai avec l'Italie. Et puis bien sûr, je voudrais remercier beaucoup du fond du cœur Laura Lee Downs pour l'éloge chaleureux et précis qu'elle a tenu à faire de moi. Je sais ce que je lui dois, à tout point de vue, du point de vue d'aujourd'hui, mais aussi du point de vue de la création qui est la sienne. Elle croise avec beaucoup de symphonie, elle est musicienne aussi, l'histoire des femmes, l'histoire du genre, l'histoire de l'enfance, l'histoire comparative, dans une perspective comparative internationale. C'est vraiment un très beau chemin et il est magnifique qu'elle soit ici titulaire d'une chaire de Gender History. Gender History qui est depuis quelques années une dimension essentielle de la pensée et de la réflexion. Chers collègues et amis, nous affrontons aujourd'hui les mêmes difficultés. La guerre au Moyen-Orient, l'émigration, le terrorisme, le développement des populismes en Europe. Très récemment, en janvier 2016, la maire de Lampedusa, Gina Licolini, recevait à Paris le prix Simone de Beauvoir pour son action à l'égard des migrants qu'elle accueille à Lampedusa. Et elle nous disait à ce moment les difficultés qui étaient les siennes et le désir qu'elle avait d'une solidarité plus grande en Europe. L'Europe, notre horizon, notre avenir envers et contre tout, et auquel, à laquelle l'Institut contribue pleinement. Aussi, en vous remerciant à nouveau de l'honneur que vous me faites, je forme du fond du cœur des vœux pour que votre beau navire dans cette belle terre continue. Merci.
Present Michel Perrault for admission to an honorary degree of Doctor of the European University Institute.
Admit you to the honorary degree of Doctor of the European University Institute.
I invite Honorary Promoter Laszlo Brust to address Ivan Sleleni.
Ladies and gentlemen, dear Mr. President, highly esteemed colleagues, respected distinguished guests. Ivan Sleleni has been one of the most important analysts of social and political change in Central and Eastern Europe, initiator of major debates about state socialist societies and the nature of post-communist social and economic transformations. He has carried on for almost four decades an overarching macro-sociological project which ranks among the very top enterprises of the discipline. His first book, his Intellectuals on the Road to Class Power, co-authored with George Conrad, offered the first robust, empirically grounded critique of the dominating theories of state socialism and an encompassing analysis of the changing role of technocrats, bureaucrats, and humanistic intelligentsia in that social formation. He was awarded for this book even before its publication by arrest, police harassment, and expulsion from his country. This expulsion pushed Ivan Seleni to the global scene to play the role of intellectual leader and institution builder in four continents, starting in Australia, then in the United States, and back in Eastern and Central Europe with some detour in Abu Dhabi. If the fate of the book and the fate of its author has some element of irony, there is much more irony in the book and then in all of Ivan Seleni's other books as a consciously used method of inquiry and critical social analysis. Second, his book Socialist Entrepreneurs and Bourgeoisement in Rural Hungary offered a broad theoretical foundation for the study of the factors of social transformation in state socialist regimes, and it served as a basis for the study of post-communist social change. Third, just to list one of his books on post-communist societies, is Making Capitalism Without Capitalists, co-authored with Gilayal, can be read as a general theory of social change as well as an analytical treatise of the transformation of class structure in post-communist societies. Ivan Seleni has always asked big questions, and he has provoked major debates about developmental pathways in socialist and post-socialist societies. He has always rejected the 20th century version of positivism as a description and justification of the existing world as the only possible one. In his work, he calls for irony and critical stance. The ironic analyst does not have to formulate a positive statement about the most desirable or the best solution. Ironic analysis only has to persuade the other that there is a range of possible solutions, and there are multiple ways to perceive and rank those solutions as desirable. Seriousness assumes faith in the supremacy of a position. The ironic analyst does not occupy such moral high ground and wants to convince others that they do not occupy such high ground either. As a proud, self-declared neoclassical sociologist, Ivan Seleni rejects any intellectual claim to represent others or to tell them what to do. The goal of social inquiry, he claims, is to provide tools for analysis that are useful for social actors, either because they dispel mystifications or because they allow social actors to measure, calculate, and explain their lives and social world. Ironic critic of the status quo aims to expose the arbitrariness of the present without trying to dictate to social actors what to do. The purpose of such irony is to enrich public dialogue by casting doubt on what was taken for granted before the dialogue began. The unity of Ivan Seleni's scholarly work also derives from his self-positioning as an intellectual, both academic and public. And this theme runs through his work from the beginning, pages of intellectuals on the road to class power to his recent vision of neoclassical sociology. With his work and activism as a public intellectual, Ivan Sereni has made visible the transformation of Eastern and Central Europe over the past decades. As a Central European scholar, he had the courage and clarity of mind to highlight the unexpected ways in which the state socialist and post-communist societies developed in many diverse ways. Besides being a scholar and a public intellectual, Ivan Sereni has been a major institution builder in the global field of sociology. He has directed top sociology departments throughout the US, including those at the University of California, Los Angeles, University of Wisconsin, Madison, and Yale. He has played a key role in designing and monitoring the social science research programs of several key universities, including the Central European University, and has served on numerous committees, including juries at the EUI. His achievements have now been widely acknowledged. He is an elected ordinary member of the Hungarian Academy of Sciences and elected fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. But above all, he has remained a dedicated observer, both passionate and professional, of the eastern half of Europe and the life of its people. The European University Institute is proud to add Professor Ivan Sereni to its list of honorary doctorates to acknowledge his unique contributions to the field of sociology. I present Ivan Sereni for admission to the honorary degree of Doctor of the European University Institute.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. President, dear graduating student, dear colleagues, well, I would like to spend begin this with personal remarks. Between 1964 and 65, I spent a year as a postdoctoral fellow in the United States at Columbia and in Berkeley. And Americans, as usually do when they meet somebody from abroad, they kept asking me, "Where are you from?" And I was wondering how to respond. At one point, I decided, from the distance of New York or San Francisco, I will just say, "I'm from Europe. I'm a European." Then I spent 40 years in the US teaching at various American universities, and I became a European American. Somehow, at that distance, the small European nation states kind of merged together for me. The unit was really Europe. During these 40 years, I had the privilege to be invited to European University Institute many times. I never taught here, but I participated in a number of PhD exams. I was a member of search committees, and so on and so forth. And I always felt very much at home. After all, as a European, I was at the European University Institute. Now, it's a particular honor for me to receive this degree, especially from the European University Institute. I feel finally I am being recognized as a European. I am being recognized formally as a member of this community. I want to thank you very, very much for this recognition, and I wish the graduating students the best of luck in this beautiful Europe. Thank you very much.
On behalf of the university, I admit you to the honorary degree of Doctor of the European University Institute. Congratulations, sir.
Time for some music, some musical interludes. I'm very pleased to welcome the EUI choir under direction of Valerio Del Piccolo, and they will perform for us today and now the Magnificat in D from Johann Pachelbel. That was a lovely musical intermezzo. Thank you very much. We will now proceed with the award of the doctoral degrees and start with the doctoral degrees in history and civilization. Can you please stand up?
Custodians of our memory, of times both good and evil, and of our rich and diverse civilization, by the authority vested in me, I admit you to the degree of Doctor of History and Civilization.
Pablo Abascal Sherwell Raúl.
Congratulations.
Laura Miriam Almagor.
Congratulations.
Romain Bonnet. Elena Borghi.
Congratulations.
Paul Dalmau Palette. Etienne Deschamps.
Congratulations.
Vedran Duancic. José Miguel Escribano Páez.
Congratulations.
David Freis. Maria Halle.
Congratulations.
Hakon Andreas Ikonomu. Elena Ioriu. Ifa Kyok Daveri.
Congratulations.
Piotr
Stéphane Kissiel.
Congratulations.
Tilman Kulke. Jakob Lehne. Valentina Marcella. Goran Musić. Diana Maria Natterman.
Bravo, congratulations.
Carolina Obradors Suazo. Brian Chair Olsen.
Congratulations.
Miguel Palau Espinosa.
Congratulations, sir.
Magnus Kvistert.
Congratulations.
Davide Romano. Andrea Talaber. Per Titke.
Congratulations.
Trond Øve Tøllesen.
Congratulations.
Dale Edgar Van Este. Florian Wagner.
Congratulations.
We proceed with the doctoral degrees in economics. Can you please stand up? Thank you.
Custodians of our prosperity and commitment to a life of economic dignity for all, by the authority vested in me, I admit you to the degree of Doctor of Economics.
Angela Abate. Pavel Brendler. Reinhard Elwanger.
Congratulations, sir.
Piodomiro Francisco Ferreira, Mallorca.
Congratulations.
Matteo Fiorini.
Congratulations, well done.
André Gama Nogueira.
Well done.
Abian Garcia Rodriguez.
Congratulations, sir.
Andrew Richard Kimber.
Well done, congratulations.
Ricardo Alfredo Mendez Pereira Vincente.
Well done.
Wojciech Pachos.
Well done, congratulations.
Marek Andrzej Raczko.
Well done, congratulations.
We continue with the doctoral degrees in law. Can you please stand up?
Custodians of our liberties, of our commitment to a society based on justice and the rule of law, by the authority vested in me, I admit you to the degree of Doctor of Laws.
Danai Angeli. Gonzalo Miguel Baña Colliu.
Congratulations. Well done.
Constantina Bania.
Well done.
Marta Cantero Gamito. Carlo Maria Cantore. Jonathan Chevry. David Kutz. Emmanuel Herman de Groof. Veronika Drążewska. Hanna Eklund. Javier Alexis Galana Villa. Alexandre Skander Galant. Katarzyna Gracz. Javier Habib.
Bravo.
Emma Linklater. Alice Margaria. Maria Benedita Menéndez Queiroz. Jakob Öberg. Maria Lisa Öberg. Vera Pablo. Leonardo Pier Domenici. Maria Luisa Ribeiro Lorenzen. Marco Rizzi.
Bravo.
Cornelius Wiesener. Time for a second intermezzo musical interlude, which will be performed by again the EUI Women's Ensemble under the direction of Valerio Del Piccolo. They will bring two pieces, Prélude et Chanson de Mai de Jules Massenet, followed by Spring by Gustav Holst. Doctoral degrees in political and social sciences. Can you please stand up?
Custodians of our commitment to good governance and democracy, even in the most challenging of times, by the authority vested in me, I admit you to the degree of Doctor of Political and Social Sciences.
Lorenzo Cini.
Congratulations, well done.
Céline Colombo. Chiara Ludovica Comolli. Benedetta Cotta. Justina Mina Ianadal. Johanna Louise Demrick. Eliska Drapalova. David Karas. Julia Koskiakova. Marat Markert.
Congratulations, well done.
Patricia McMillan. Milan Obaidi.
Congratulations, well done.
Asli Celine Okiai.
Bravo.
St- Stefano Palestini Cespedes.
Congratulations, bravo.
Traike Panov.
Congratulations, well done.
Frédéric Roche. Tomáš Siček.
Well done, congratulations.
Davide Vampa.
Congratulations, well done.
Christian Vasil.
Congratulations.
Andrea Ulrike Warnecke. Rebecca Wolfberg.
Congratulations, very well done.
Lorenzo Zamponi. Carolina Viviana Zuccotti.
Congratulations, well done.
And we conclude with this, with the awarding of the LL.M degrees. Can you please stand up?
By authority vested in me, I admit you to the degree of Masters of Laws.
Esther Nancy Drapkin Reiter.
Congratulations.
Christopher James Johnson.
Well done, congratulations.
Aoife Nannery.
Thank you.
Philip Tam. And Mikhail Patsov.
Well done, sir. Thank you. It was wonderful.
Every year, prizes are awarded to the best thesis in a number of disciplines. I invite Professor Martin Scheinin, the Dean of Graduate Studies, to award those diplomas.
It is the pleasant task of the EUI Dean to announce the winners of this year's five thesis prizes for the best PhD thesis, either in a department or in a more specific field. Many excellent PhD theses are annually approved at the EUI. Some of them are beyond excellent, namely exceptional. I will now invite onto the stage the following five individuals whose achievements belong to this latter category of exceptional. From the Department of History and Civilization, Valentina Marcella. From the Department of Economics, Pavel Brendler. From Law, Bosko Tripkovic. And Jonathan Severin. From the SPS department, Anna Auf dem Brinke. We start with the James K. Memorial Prize for the best thesis in history and visuality. This prize was created in memory of James K., who came from the United States to the EUI and obtained his PhD at the Department of History and Civilization in 2003. In an untimely and tragic way, he passed away in February 2011 in an accident on the river Arno that flows through Florence and is essential for the history and visual image of Florence. The prize that carries James K.'s name and lasting memory is given for the best PhD thesis that combines the study of historical and visual sources. The 2016 James K. Memorial Prize is awarded to Valentina Marcella for her thesis Laughing Matters, Mainstream Political Cartoons Under the Military Regime of the Early 1980s in Turkey, defended in December 2015. She's a native of Italy, exemplifying the close ties between the European University Institute and our generous host country. Congratulations. The Vilfredo Pareto Prize for the best doctoral thesis in economics was quite recently established by our Department of Economics to honor Vilfredo Pareto, who lived 1848 to 1923, a French-born Italian sociologist, economist, political scientist, and philosopher, who as professor worked at the University of Lausanne in Switzerland, but before that he lived here in Florence for a decade, working towards his major contribution for economics as a modern scientific discipline. The 2016 Vilfredo Pareto Prize is awarded to Pavel Brender for his thesis, Essays on Income Equality, Political Inequality and Income Redistribution in the US, defended in June 2016, just in time before today's event. He's a German national. Congratulations. The Antonio Cassese Prize for the best thesis in international law was created by the Department of Law in honor of the outstanding Italian professor and lawyer Antonio Cassese, who lived 1937 to 2011 and was among the most distinguished figures in international law and international criminal justice. His long and diverse career includes working as professor both here at the EUI and at the University of Florence, as well as serving as the first president of the International Criminal Tribunal for former Yugoslavia, created in 1993. The 2016 Antonio Cassese Prize is awarded to Jonathan Chevry from France for his thesis, Convergence of International Trade and Investment Law in Practice, How Should Investor State Arbitral Tribunals Engage with Trade Norms, defended in December 2015. Congratulations. The Mauro Capelletti Prize for the best thesis in comparative law is named after Mauro Capelletti, who lived 1927 to 2004, another great Italian scholar who also was professor both at the EUI and the University of Florence, as well as in the United States at Stanford University. The 2016 Mauro Capelletti Prize is awarded to Bosco Tripkovic for his thesis, The Meta-Ethics of Constitutional Adjudication, defended in May 2015. He is one of our outstanding graduates recruited from non-EU countries, being of Serbian nationality. Congratulations. And one more. The Linz Rokan Prize in Political Sociology was created in honor of the Norwegian political scientist and sociologist Stein Rokan, 1921 to 1979, who was most active at the University of Bergen, and the German-born Spanish sociologist and political scientist Juan Linz, 1926 to 2013, best known for his work at Yale University in the United States. The 2016 winner of the Linz-Rokan Prize is Anna Aufden-Brinke for her thesis, The Political Economy of Financial Risks and Preferences, defended in May 2015. She is German by nationality. Congratulations, congratulations to you all.
I would like to invite Dr. Carolina Obradors for a final salute.
Dear President, dear Valedegmin, dear colleagues, dear professors, dear family and friends, queridos todos, chers tous. I'm much grateful to Valedegmin for having thought about me for this salute. I could not have imagined, indeed, a better opportunity to bid farewell to the EUI and all the fantastic people I've met here. Let me start, very originally, by recycling a quotation from my dissertation, the words of a famous medieval Catalan thinker, Francesc Eiximenis. A Franciscan friar, Eiximenis was rather skeptical, and I beg pardon to my fellow lawyers for this reference, towards jurists, for he thought they were more devoted to their own profits than to the common good. He depicted his suspicions through the image of a peasant, who, having confused a law school and its students with a populated church, started praying in the middle of a lecture. When one of the attendants informed him about the real nature of the meeting, the peasant showed his concern, foreseeing the damage that so many future academics could cause to the common good. Alas, the earth is now lost, as only one jurist can do so much harm. It is to be deduced that all of you, being so numerous, will destroy the world. Oh, yes, masqui, tota la terra és perduda, car un sol jurista que està entre nos a tots ha desfet, segueix que vosaltres, qui tant sou, tot lo món destruireu. In this equally populated church, I believe this poor peasant would be even more confused. With not only lawyers, but also political scientists, sociologists, economists, and historians. A very weird collection of people, you will agree. My role would then be to calm him down and to guarantee that he's in good company. And surrounded by people who, albeit coming from different countries, cultures, and traditions, have been used day after day to live, dialogue, and think together. People who have been trained to commit to the building of a broader, more generous, united, peaceful Europe, a better one. To find my most convincing words and avoid this poor peasant suffering a syncope, I would have to speak from my heart, sharing with him, as I'm going to do with you, my personal experience as a researcher at the Department of History and Civilization here at the EUI. I hope he would then understand that after years of hard professional development, but maybe more importantly, intense years of shared experiences, personal maturation, and emotional discoveries, EUI graduates are good company. A bunch of very serious and rigorous people who came here to start a new life far away from home and naturally developed the habit to listen to and share with their fellow colleagues data, interests, references, but also evenings, roofs, joys, and anxieties. As a result, the DNA of many of them is based on generosity, empathy, and flexibility. The intensity of these last 5 years makes it actually difficult for me to describe them in 5-10 minutes, a bit less now already. Allow me, please, to be brief in regard to the qualities of the doctoral program. Without doubt, this is a place where we are pushed to question our previous academic backgrounds. We are taught not to forget them, but rather to enrich them by adopting critical views on different ways of thinking and analyzing. Our writing is, since day one, nourished with continuous rethinking, questioning, and rewriting, this being very different from what I was used to at home. In my case, I felt in many occasions that my thesis was like Penelope's tapestry. By some weird effect, maybe related to my dreams, mornings were devoted to erase or restructure what had been written the previous day. In these moments of crisis and plain frustration, my supervisor and other readers, within and without the EUI, found time to read, smile, and calm me down. Respecting my rhythm, they always managed to convince me, even if it was only for a short time, until the next meeting, that one stitch can make the difference and that the cloth I was weaving on medieval citizens was solid enough. For their help, humor, and constant availability, I am more than grateful. Indeed, thanks to them and to many others at the EUI, my doctoral experience has been a healthy, balanced one. And this should appease my dear peasant. Jokes aside, this is, in my opinion, what makes the EUI more than a research institute of excellence. Although settling in Florence alone, researchers do not feel as such, for they are constantly supported in their personal and professional needs. This, at least, has been the case for me, and I think for many of my colleagues. At the History Department, where all of us work on such different topics, collaboration rather than any sort of competition has cultivated relationships among us, and we have mutually enriched our work by finding and discussing common concerns in a cordial atmosphere. The healthiness of our academic life is also guaranteed by the efficiency of the administrative staff, who are always available to make our lives easier, providing any resources needed. I shall not forget the revitalizing smiles and friendly comments of those feeding us every day in the mensas. It has always been so grateful to go for a break and find Paolas, Lucias, Lulias, Antonellas, smiling faces, ready to joke and to talk about everything but medieval citizenship. Yet in my case, it is the progressive involvement in extracurricular activities that made these years a most complete and balanced experience. Whilst the Laboratorio di Scrittura with Anarita Zacchi gave me the opportunity to share my memories in written form and to meet many talented researchers in the Festival of Arts, the Atelier Théâtre Francophone with Chantal Mahouj made it possible for me to revive my old passion for theater. These activities gave me the possibility to practice foreign languages and meet more people from other departments. But much more importantly, they helped me enormously to keep developing other ways to express myself, to make sense of emotions that constant academic writing was slowly burying, automatizing. With their energy and professional competence, these two fantastic women succeed in awakening our creativity, connecting us more strongly with the real world, even when remaining in these magic hills. Finally, the EUI is, I think, a space of friendship that has drastically broadened my horizons. While settling in a new country, for the hospitality of which we should all be grateful, I've learned here to treat my Spanish, Italian, English, French, Turkish, Dutch, Danish, German fellow researchers as brothers and sisters with whom I shared routines, joys, anxieties, library hours, coffees, pizzas. This has strongly developed my European identification, a feeling that I will always hold dear in my heart. For now, I have some very dear friends living across the continent and even well beyond. It is here where I met my companion in life during these last 5 years, and I deeply hope so for all the others to come. For sure then, my feelings and my memory will always be a bit biased. This will never be for me, not for many others with similar stories. Just a research institute, not an important stage in my professional development. Rather, the EUI has been for me a fundamental vital experience, a place of friendship and love that drastically changed my life and what I wanted to do with it. Dear peasant, I hope you would now understand that we are not to be feared. Please don't run away and wait for us. We are hard-working people devoted to human knowledge
who now found a moment to dress up and celebrate that we've somehow contributed to an academic endeavor and that some of our dreams have come true. Our only concern might now be to leave this church with you and to be then the confused ones, for we have been very spoiled in the hills of Fiesole. Yet do not worry. I hope we'll be helpful. And in any case, I'm sure that in one way or another, we have all acquired here the values, the strength, the skills and the will to work, think and write with you and for you. Grazie mille, arrivederci, merci beaucoup et au revoir. Muchísimas gracias y hasta pronto.
Come to an end. It's a kind of interesting and special occasion where 100 or so people come in as bachelors and masters, and with a few magic words they are suddenly doctors. And of course most credit goes to them and their hard work, but it would not have happened with two other groups of people, our wonderful professors who are sitting behind me, who supervised, guided, directed, taught, chided, and the wonderful staff of the European University Institute. So I would like to end by inviting you, ladies and gentlemen, and you, to join me in an applause to our professors and our staff. Thank you all very much.
Carolina was referring in her last sentence that there is no concern to leave the church. Well, there is a concern to leave the church, because we cannot, as usual, leave the church by the back door, because there is a problem there with falling stones. So I would ask you to all go leave the church by that way, but in two parts. The first part is the doctors who are going to leave the church by that way for a photograph with the President and the Secretary General. And after that, I will invite you to leave the church. So having said that, I wish you all a very pleasant afternoon and a very exciting June ball.